So, you know, what are my qualifications for debating a dean of law on constitutional law? I was brought up with Rumpole of the Bailey, and I watch Suits. Those are my two main qualifications. But I've been in a number of debates on this topic, and it's generally an unfair debate because I'm armed with the unfair advantage of ethical and moral realities being on my side. I have all of the valid evidence on my side, facts and data on my side, and not to mention the law. But I'm just one of a group of that included six patients fighting against unjust Canadian laws that are literally causing illness, suffering, and death in the Canadian population. It was in 1994 that the Canadian Bar Association published this book, which you see illustrated, and it accurately predicted the role of the law in reforming healthcare. The answer to the title question, what's the law got to do with it, is everything. Lorne will oppose my opinion, but as a dean of law, he should be proud of the role his colleagues will play in Canadian healthcare reform. The last time I was scheduled, and I too would like to acknowledge Lorne's bravery in tackling this debate, the last time I was scheduled to debate with a dean of law on this topic was about 20 years ago on a live CBC debate. Andrew Petter, who is now a university president, was a dean of law, and at the time of the scheduled debate, he was the Minister of Health in British Columbia. He withdrew at a day's notice from the debate because he had not been adequately briefed to debate health law with an orthopedic surgeon.
By saying, I was originally scheduled to debate these issues with Andrew Petter, who declined to come on. And
Mr. Petter, by the way, I remind our viewers in the other nine provinces, of course, is the health minister for BC. We got our rapid results or rapid response results. We do. In response to the question, do private health clinics threaten Medicare? 27% of you said yes. 73% of you said no. There you go. We are done.
So that was a That was a CBC audience, and you can probably imagine they're not necessarily to the right of center. I think it's important for us to recognize that history includes a legacy of laws that were unethical, immoral, and illegal. As such, laws allowed slavery, apartheid, racial and sexual discrimination. Laws existed in my lifetime that declared homosexuality and suicide illegal. I also include in that category laws with Orwellian names, like in BC, the Medicare Protection Act, and in Ontario, the Commitment to the Future of Medicare Act. These laws force patients to suffer in pain and even die as they wait for necessary care. I believe those who created or enforced such laws are responsible for the deaths of Canadians, and they belong in jail. Mind you, I also believe in the death penalty for the likes of Clifford Olson. So who can possibly believe it's wrong to be able to buy insurance against sickness when you're alive, but okay to buy insurance in case one dies? Who can justify the fact that an animal owner can legally buy health insurance for the pets they love, but not for the human relatives that they love almost as much? In Chowley, the majority applied ethical and moral and legal principles in determining that elected politicians do not have the right to override the freedoms that our parents and grandfathers fought for in two world wars. Politicians are rated by citizens among the sleaziest and least respected of all workers. It's our duty to challenge laws that they create when they are based on prejudice and false logic. I'm comforted by the fact that even among deans of the Osgoode Hall Law School, two of Lorne's predecessors as dean, Peter Hogg and Patrick Monaghan, who is currently the Deputy Attorney General here in Ontario, I believe, support my views. So you're outnumbered 2-1 in Dean's, Lorne. So how has the current status come about? We virtually canonized Tommy Douglas, who's been falsely credited with introducing Medicare in Canada. This man, voted by some CBC viewers as the greatest ever Canadian, believed and wrote his thesis on culling those he called subnormal, endorsing Hitler's philosophy on the issue. However, even he believed that we should pay premiums for healthcare. Our opponents are quick to provide so-called expert views on the topic of reform. Every single study they quote, and I mean everyone, is flawed and inaccurate. That is why we are anxious to have a judge review the evidence and facts rather than opinion. One of our strategies in court will be to dispel false information that has been replicated by numerous groups opposed to divorce and to reform. And I include this slide because some of these issues were brought up this morning. But just because something is entrenched in a belief or in the literature does not mean it's true. And what happens is these beliefs become prejudices. So just as an example, there's nothing about Adam and Eve and an apple in the Bible. Jonah was not swallowed by a whale. There's no evidence clinically that the Hatter was mad. Sherlock Holmes never said elementary, my dear Watson, and so on and so on. King Wenceslas was only a duke. Nelson was not blind. Bats can see perfectly well. And Banting and Best did not discover penicillin. Even more sinister is James Bond. If you read Fleming's original work, he liked his martinis stirred, not shaken. So my point is, always check on your facts and data before you believe them. One of our strategies has been, therefore, as I said, to dispel myths. But another is thing we're faced with is government and trade union hired mercenaries who will present their opinions in court. These are called expert witnesses. Some of them are in denial of the fact that there's a sustainability problem caused by our aging population. By the way, the slide at the top is just to show the baby boomer generation. It's my school picture from 1958. I'm sitting on the front row, standing at the back row are Paul McCartney and George Harrison. Some of the denial about the costs of chronic disease and the aging population and increased technology. And essentially what we're doing here is we are mortgaging our future on the backs of our youth. Long wait lists in Canada are medically harmful and economically stupid. Canada is literally paying tens of billions of dollars in order to keep patients waiting. The Commonwealth Fund is a non-profit foundation that focuses on the issues that affect vulnerable and low-income Americans. In ranking 11 health systems in the developed world economies, Canada was next to last and the US was last. And there are many other studies around the world that come out with similar conclusions. A 2015 book by a British author, Mark Britnell, attempted to describe using 12 categories what a perfect health system would look like. 12 countries contributed to the list, and not one in the list is Canada. This slide illustrates the arrogance of our opponents. Read the captions. Charles Wright is a contributor to Lorne and Colleen Flood's book. He was an expert witness in the Chowley case. His quote illustrates a disdain for patient rights. He actually admitted lying under oath in the Chowley case, in which he was, and I say this in quotes, an expert witness. Jonathan Lomas, a government-funded bureaucrat, endorsed Wright's view that citizens are too stupid to be trusted with looking after their own health. Surveys of doctors in Canada have revealed that 26% have had a patient die on a wait list. The Supreme Court of Canada in Charlie ruled that Canadians are suffering and dying on wait lists. This is a sad reflection on our situation. Data from around the world shows that we have an expensive and inefficient scheme by every measurable criterion. Studies using freedom of information access have shown that our system is inefficient, even when compared to US Medicare. False self-reporting of administrative costs in Canada was exposed by Dr. Barry Turchin in 2008. Our public system has 11 times as many public bureaucrats draining its resources as Germany does. Yet Germany has universal healthcare without waitlists. Does anyone really believe this is unrelated to the fact that German public health bureaucrats are exposed to competition? A group called Canadian Doctors for Medicare is intervening against us and our patients in our lawsuit. Their vice chair, Dr. Bob Woollard, presented false data in a debate he had with me before the whole class of UBC medical students. He showed on this slide that rising health costs were not a problem. His slide was a scam with a purposefully distorted horizontal axis scale. It was designed to deceive. This is what the data really looked like when the horizontal scale was corrected to equal time increments. The following clip, near the end of our debate with between Woollard and myself, illustrates the contrast in perceptions of what each of us believes constitutes timely access to care.
Google's a great thing, right? So yesterday when I found I was going to do, I realized, I should Google Dr. Woollard and see what he said about access and healthcare. And first thing came up was a quote. I was in the quote on the front page of the LA Times, so was Bob. Here's the quote when asked about the Canadian health system. Woollard said, "The public system has the nimbleness to provide speedy, quality care to those who truly need it. Just 6 or 8 weeks ago, I had a patient come in who needed urgent attention to her knee. She was in severe pain," he said. "She was seen by a reviewing team within a week, and she was slated for surgery that will probably happen in the next 2 to 3 months. That's 5 months in severe pain. Bob, that is not the health system that I aspire for in Canada. I think we can do a lot better."
You can see how frozen he is throughout. Health economist Robert Evans' career has been based on the view that increased health costs were a result of too many doctors treating too many patients. Based on his advice, medical schools across the country were cut back. The result? Canada has a shortage of doctors. In the early 70s, when I came to Canada, we were ranked fourth in the world in the number of doctors per population. Today, we rank 26, thanks to Dr. Evans and to the deputy ministers that endorsed his views. Canada does not have a comprehensive, universal, accessible, or portable system. Drugs, artificial limbs after amputations, ambulances after a heart attack are covered only for those with private insurance. The worst outcomes and the worst access in Canada are in the poorer and underprivileged classes. 70% of us have private, what I call two-tier insurance. The groups listed on the right are privileged and able to bypass Canadian discriminatory laws. We are fighting for the right of unjailed Canadians to have the same freedoms granted to those in jail.
You're on. There is a critical decision coming. And when the time comes, Dr. Day is confident a change is coming too.
If you support the status quo, then you are supporting a system that is killing patients. This is something the Supreme Court of Canada said, not Brian Day.
You know, I like to point out that the government went to court in the recent assisted suicide trial to argue against the rights of dying patients to die without pain and suffering. In our trial, which is scheduled for June of this year, and it will be precedent-setting after it goes through the various levels of the courts, it will be precedent-setting for every province. In our trial, they will argue against the rights of living patients to live without pain and suffering. The final clip in my talk summarizes what will likely be a 4 to 5 month trial in one short minute.
There's a fundamental difference between forcing someone to pay. When we refer to bad old days, when someone would be bankrupted by illness, that's because they were forced to pay when they became ill. There's a fundamental difference between forcing someone to pay and allowing them to pay. And the thought we'd like to leave you on is, I think tomorrow you'll be hearing a case in which parents of autistic children were paying for a service that government, I'm sure, will tell you that they have limited resources. This is probably what they'll tell you tomorrow. They have limited resources, and therefore they cannot provide them. But imagine the following scenario. Imagine the government decides to cover the service, but then affects so few resources to it that it won't be possible to have a two-year waiting list to get in the program. And then imagine that you prohibit those parents from paying themselves if they want the service, even though it's not available. And then you have the facts of our case.
That simple statement sums up our case. And as Patrick Monaghan, the previous dean of Osgoode Hall, has said, and Senator Kirby said, the government can't have it both ways. You can't promise access, not deliver it, and then outlaw a citizen's right to that access in a free and democratic society. Thank you.
This is an issue that I've wrestled with, and if we differ at all, Brian and I think it's with the certainty of his convictions and the fact that I've had my views evolve, continue to evolve. I learn from each exposure to new ideas, and again, the reference to every piece of evidence and report you'll see on the other side is flawed is not surprisingly exactly what that other side will say about all the evidence and reports relied on. And just as Brian was saying, he's not here to try to debate the interstices of particular constitutional provisions. It's not his preserve. I don't want to take issue with whose reports and which evidence and what jurisdiction should we compare ourselves to. Is it Germany? Is it the US? Is it the UK? And which study is really the compelling one? Because that's not my argument, although I do like this cartoon, which talks about the reality. At least I read this cartoon as talking about the reality that all those constitutional interstices, as compelling and interesting and important as they are, will not and have not changed waitlists and have not affected the very real suffering, anxiety, and sense of helplessness and hopelessness that so many vulnerable people, and not vulnerable people in a financial sense, but vulnerable in a health sense, have felt for too many years, across too many parts of the country, for too long. So I think there is no, I hope, no sense in which I'm here to say the status quo is just fine, let's double down and embrace it even more. The real difference of opinion, both between Brian and I think more broadly, that shapes this particular debate, at least since Shaouli through the Allen case I'll talk a bit about in Alberta to the forthcoming BC litigation, is who is best placed to solve this and solve it in a comprehensive and holistic, enduring, sustaining, fair and just way. And I would say to that question, notwithstanding the deep respect and regard I have for David Stratis, who's here today, and maybe the one exception to what I'm about to say, judges are remarkably poorly placed to be in that position, given the limited access to knowledge, understanding, training, capacity, competence that they bring to this incredibly important, complex debate with moving parts, seen and unseen, that shape the pickle we're in. So hold that thought, because I want to come back to it. So that, in effect, is my argument, not that we should bar people from seeking private health insurance if they can afford it. Certainly many countries that we see as peers, both in our welfare state, our democratic system, our social values in Europe, Scandinavia, elsewhere, have managed some form of hybrid. If the ideological stalwarts on the other side were here, they would be quick to point out we already have somewhere in the neighborhood of 30% of Canadian healthcare that is private, done in clinics all across the country, and we manage that not by a parallel system, but simply by delisting or not including certain important health services within the ambit of public health insurance. And the difference between optometry and ophthalmology, the difference between forms of orthopedic surgery deemed as cosmetic or deemed as health-related, all sorts of arbitrary distinctions go into what we call public and private now, or at least available for public insurance or private insurance, not to mention the very significant, growing, and I think far too little scrutinized market shaping our healthcare system, which is medicine and pharmacare. And I think if there's any change to the status quo that I would put highest on the list, and one says that, you know, never to discount all the other compelling priorities, I think it's sorting out how we pay for drugs. Because when you look at our peer jurisdictions, New Zealand's often cited, but there are others, it is remarkable how much more we pay for no clear rationale than most of the rest of the world in a peer jurisdiction sense for similar kinds of products. And again, markets work not in an insidious or unjust or unfair way. Markets work as markets work. You create incentives, those incentives will be responded to. We've created incentives in many ways that are dysfunctional. But I would suggest in none of those ways have we created a system that fails to meet the constitutional threshold as it's been established. And what I'll come back to is, again, the constitutional dimensions of this have been a form of workaround. The workaround that we're dealing with is a workaround of political system, which may be because it's been drinking the Kool-Aid of myth for too long, or accepting a wisdom from Tommy Douglas onwards that has never been subject to the appropriate scrutiny, fair and open kinds of debates it should. And I'm open to all those allegations. And again, the more I explore about the system, the more frustrated I get with its dysfunctions, its opaqueness, its unjustified winners and losers across different diseases, parts of the country, et cetera. It doesn't accord to what I would want to see as the core principles of fairness, coherence, you know, rational allocation of resources, et cetera. But then my recourse is to vote these bums out, get other bums in who share my way of thinking. The workaround that we're talking about is a workaround our political system, our policy process, and that's the principal objection. So the Shaouli case and the plight of Mr. Zeliotis has already been invoked, and I won't rehearse it. I think it's would be surprising if it's not well known to most of you. But let me just focus on why I think it's a bad day for the Supreme Court, just as Askov once before it was a not particularly good day for the Supreme Court. These are days in which the court is trying to play a Goldilocks role. The court is trying to say not there's a fundamental right and freedom, as it could have. It could have said there is a fundamental right to health care. It is unacceptable under Section 7 that anyone's security of person, life, and liberty is subject to harm. There is an obligation on the state to care for everyone in this country, period, in timely and effective ways. It would solve the wait time problem. It would solve every ill so far that I've heard Dr. Day suggest, which is the real pain and suffering that ought to be our focus. That would be done. Courts would set the directive. governments would comply, and rather than just a narrow majority of our entire budget, tax dollar driven, healthcare would simply grow and grow and grow, because that constitutional imperative would be non-negotiable, just as a legal aid budget for criminal representation for defendants isn't subject to government priorities. It grows according to the court process because it's a non-negotiable, irreducible minimum guarantee from state coffers to people to uphold constitutional rights. So in other words, why go halfway? Why make the constitutional case about this arcane distinction between public and private insurance? If pain and suffering is the mischief, why isn't there simply a freestanding constitutional right not to endure the pain and suffering that comes from wait lists? But again, I think the unhappy medium is where the Goldilocks court finds itself, having to arbitrate things like, is 12 months an unreasonable and unconstitutional infringement on the bar for people to seek private insurance? Sorry, should it be 10 months? No, hang on, 14 months for hips, 8 months for cataracts, maybe 11 and a half months for cancer treatment, because that's the world they're in. Right, the test coming out of Shaouli that at least 4 out of 7, minority of the court, but plurality of the bench, and it's not really 4, it's 3+1 on the charter, but 4 under the Quebec Charter of Human Rights and Freedoms, was in a world in which they would arbitrate what is unreasonable as a delay or not a reasonably justified delay, and only in those cases would access to private health insurance be constitutionally compelled, which again, Dr. Day's challenge in BC, and more kudos to him for bringing it, for sticking with it over many years to try to get it off the ground in the face of really a groundswell of opposition who would love to see it never see the light of day, no pun intended. I think it should. I think we should have more litigation of this kind that doesn't dance around the edges of issues, leave constitutional doors slightly ajar but not walk through them. We ought to have more open, and I think, full, complete litigation about the issues that matter to us most. And that's really what Dr. Day seeks to bring, as I understand the litigation from at least the published material on it coming this summer. Not a small carve-out for where there is a unjustified wait time, but a broad end to the broad ban on seeking private health insurance. So Shaouli, some said, already decided that, that a bar on individuals seeking private health insurance was unconstitutional. And it was held certainly in the Allen and Alberta case, just decided by the Alberta Court of Appeal this year. The applicants, the plaintiffs, took that position and said they're going to go. As a dentist who had to wait, again, a very long time, I think at 18 months or longer, for back surgery or other procedures, and ultimately went to Montana at great expense, I think somewhere around $70,000. And again, the details, if I'm not getting them right, I don't think go to the broader point, but it's a case worth reading in detail. But the argument was, well, we don't have to bring a record. We don't have to go and get all those reports and all those experts. That was done in Shaouli. And so we're simply going to assert the Shaouli precedent binds in Alberta, and I want my $70,000 back that I had to spend going to do what I could have done at much less expense if I could have used private health insurance to cover that procedure in Canada. So the court, in dismissing that, both clarified what I think is the right answer, which is Shaouli was a landmark decision about which there will be justified debate. And again, a quick plug for the book Brian mentioned, Access to Care, Access to Justice, from just in that short period after the decision, range of legal and others weighing in. And again, I wouldn't want to suggest it covers the waterfront of perspectives, and I've no doubt that Brian could add and ought to add and augment many other sources of commentary about the case, but it's a great primer on why that case was so compelling to so many. So Shaouli matters, but it matters as a beginning, not an end, to this debate. It opens up the scope for the debate, and in fact begs the question of why it ought not to be broader, because I think very few of you would defend why judges are in the best position to decide if 12 months versus 10 versus 14 is the right number for the right procedure in the right part of the country, just as Askov tried to come up with a bright line for when a wait period in prison would be contrary to the trial by a reasonable time provision Craig was talking about in the charter. The other risk, as I said, is that judges don't have the background and training to do this work. So Askov is a cautionary tale, because the reliance on the work of Karl Barr in getting to that justification for the six-month window that, of course, let huge numbers of people in Ontario out of prison where the state simply couldn't meet that deadline, mostly nonviolent, but still hard to justify as in the public interest. But again, once the court says it, compliance is mandatory. So Karl Barr got up and said, yeah, that's not what I said. You completely misread the social science data on which I founded a view, and you took conclusions in a cherry-picking and inaccurate way, which caused one of the most remarkable moments in the history of the Supreme Court. Peter Corey, in England, shortly after the decision, read Karl Barr and said, so let me tell you a bit about the case and what I think we really meant. First time in the history of the court that a judge sitting who had written and taken part in a judgment spoke not through that judgment, but in a clarifying memo to file shared with the media to try to quell this outrage that the whole decision must have been flawed if the very evidence on which it was based was misunderstood and misinterpreted. Many chapters of the Shaouli book make the case either that the evidence accepted at trial was ignored by the Supreme Court, or that Madame Justice Deschamps simply ignored key pieces of evidence, or that evidence that should have been there that would have made the case much better for Shaouli came out just after the appellate decision and wasn't there in time. So everyone argued about that evidence. But again, coming to what the Court of Appeal in Alberta said I think captures the point we're at, which sets the stage for the BC litigation to come. Having established a universal healthcare system, the court wrote, governments are prima facie entitled to put in place provisions that protect that system and prevent its abuse. Entitled, in other words, to ensure the system remains truly universal in the sense that there's not a parallel system for the wealthy and another for ordinary Canadians. That equality of access is consistent with core principles of Canadian democracy that are prima facie justified in the charter sense in a free and democratic society until there's a record and evidence that can show otherwise. So the court finished with, if an applicant wants to engage in a constitutional vivisection, nice little medical trope being dragged out, of the healthcare system, a full trial is required to justify that and to allow the government to justify its choices. So that, again, takes us to where we're at and why I differ from Brian about whether the Constitution can cure what ails our system. He referred a number of times to things that are illegal, unjust, wrong, and I don't know that I disagree with that characterization. I may disagree with the vehemence or the scope or which parts of it, but I think those are precisely the cases we make either to sitting governments to change, and in fact, since Shaouli, there has been change. Is it enough? Is it the right kind? Certain areas have been cherry-picked, like cancer care in Ontario and others across the country, and wait lists have gone down. No doubt wait lists have gone up elsewhere. No doubt any wait list, if it's your daughter or your spouse or your grandparent, is absolutely unacceptable when you see the facility and the personnel across the border there and waiting. I could book an MRI in Buffalo tomorrow. What possible justification could there be for the additional risk to wait 3 months to get an MRI, even if it's deemed not as urgent as someone else's need? So all of these, in other words, can be right and still not touch what the charter is really there to provide. So I would suggest there are two options. Either we bite the bullet and pursue the fact that the charter is going to include in its scope positive rights, and the right to health care certainly would be the top of the list. If you look at Canadian society, its values, our politics, our media, what's constitutive of our society, you could argue. Or we accept that the policy sphere, our democratic process, our elected officials ultimately have to be accountable for the flaws that do in fact ail the system. And they're not flaws that simply require more money. I haven't yet heard anyone who suggests we don't spend enough on healthcare. It's that we spend it so poorly, so dysfunctionally, with so little accountability and so much waste and squandering that leaves us in the pickle we're in. Private health insurance will solve that for those who get private health insurance, for sure, I think. At least I'm convinced in the evidence I've seen. The debate, which I'm not convinced, because the ideological luggage is just so weighty, I can't sift through it to get to a truth, is whether that, in fact, will enhance the public system. The opponents will say the creaming will, in fact, make the most complex, most expensive, hardest cases, and the least effective physicians there left to treat them as the better ones go to the private system. The proponents say this will be a rising tide that will lift all boats and will get better outcomes for private health insurance holders and the public. And they each might be right a little bit. One might be desperately wrong. I don't want David Stratis, as much as I respect him, to be the one to make that call and to decide whether it's 9 months or 11 months, depending on whether, you know, and this is the contribution I'll end on this that I make, that separates healthcare from so many other areas of right-seeking that affects us all. So the case that I make, looking at a comparison between Shaouli and an earlier case by the same judges in Gosselin, a couple of years earlier, dealing with social welfare rights, is in Gosselin, the court simply approaches it as a problem of these poor others. It was the people on welfare who, if you were below a certain age and didn't seek work, would have a penalty. And Louise Gosselin said, that brings me below what everyone accepts to be the minimum standard to meet the basic necessities of life. You, government of Quebec, cannot put me in the position of not being able to meet the basic necessities of life. And the court said, well, there might one day be a right to things like social welfare, certainly not today. But look, you've got to understand, Louise, this is for your own good. Right? We've all had kids who make bad choices. We've all had to do things that might seem like a penalty to you, but ultimately this is a public good that you're required to look for work. Trust me, you'll find work, you'll do well. That's why this system can't be unconstitutional. Versus Shaouli, where from the outset, and certainly in Madam Justice Deschamps' judgment, you feel the energy of the court saying, this is us. This isn't just people I care for, this is me. Right? This, because the premise of the system is universally allocated risk, universally allocated cost, the judges are in it, the litigants are in it, we're all in it together. And for situations where we're all in it together, I would suggest, fundamental rights and freedoms can't dictate policy outcomes. It is a much messier and much more important, much more legitimate, and ultimately much more sustaining realm of the political sphere in our democratic process that has to carry this debate forward, which is not to say, again, I'm unhappy with the litigation. Again, kudos to bring it. I hope it is a deep and rich exchange of views, and I hope we get greater clarity from the court on precisely the questions that I'm putting out there, and that we end up with a better system as a result of this litigation, not simply another lateral spinning of wheels, as many people 10 years on view Shaouli, even in Quebec, where the hoped for big change still hasn't happened. So let me stop with that to leave time for what I know will be an ample and robust rebuttal from Brian, and we'll carry on from there. Thank you very much.
Oh, yeah.
Sheets, get them out of your way.
So, I mean, I too don't believe a judge should be telling me when I can have my knee fixed. To take it to an absolute extreme, if I were a golfer and have a sore elbow that stops me playing more than 9 holes of golf, that, and I'm told there's a 6-month wait list to get it fixed. To me, even something as trivial as that, it's a violation of my rights to force me to wait 6 months. That's how extreme my views are, if you like. I think that we were very concerned about Shaouli. We didn't want Shaouli to get leave to appeal to the Supreme Court. It was a weak case. Even more unhappy about the Allen case, in which recently a member of the court who sat in Shaouli told me that, as you know, they've sought leave to appeal to the Supreme Court of Canada, and they're likely, according to the judge, the retired judge that I spoke to, likely to get it because there were errors in the appeal court level in British in Alberta. But Allan is also a weak case, and there was no evidence introduced in the Allan case, very little evidence, and they just wanted to do a cheap thing. Now I know I can understand why Lorne is happy that we're pursuing this, because we've created massive work for lawyers, and that's part of your role. And getting to the human rights issue, you know, my son, that's the other reason I'm being nice to Lorne. My son is currently at Princeton, and he's doing a kind of a thesis that involves human rights, and he might want to apply to your law school, so I can't be too mean. He and I, in his thesis, I agree that I disagree that it's a human right to be able to access healthcare, and so far, the constitutional law experts in the U.S. and Canada have agreed that you can't have a right that imposes something, makes an imposition on another individual, namely me. I think we have to put this in perspective. We're not talking about a judge deciding what is right. We're talking about you as an individual being able to choose for yourself. And I was on just a few months ago on CBC again. I keep getting asked by CBC, who aren't about the only media outlet that's not on our side. They said, you know, I made some remarks along the lines I've made today, and the interviewer said, well, are you calling the Canadian health system a communist-type system? I said, absolutely not. I said, absolutely not. I said, you know, Vietnam, Laos, communist China, North Korea, Cuba, none of them have laws like this. We are way to the left of any of those communist countries. So, and just to deal with a few of the specifics from Lorne, yes, we have 30% private healthcare, but in terms of hospital and physician services, in terms of what is actually the kind of surgery and procedures we do, 99% or thereabouts of all hospital and physician services are mandated by law that they must be performed in the public system. And this is not necessarily about making the public system better, which I think it will. I'm in favor of a strong public system. I'm not in favor of the status quo in Canada, where the poorest and the least privileged, not only do they not have the kind of private insurance that most of you have, they have the worst access and the worst outcomes. I get phone calls from people who would shock you. NDP, MLAs and MPs and union leaders to try and jump, quotes, the queue, because they believe in queues for other people but not for themselves. One of the executives from the group intervening in our case has had surgery at our private clinic. This is what we're faced with, I'll end with, I think when you personalize it, it's all different. Like, you know, none of us would shoot someone. But if we saw someone pointing a gun at our son, daughter, brother, sister, and we had a gun we could shoot them with, we'd shoot them. So we all have a threshold. So in the Senate, Kirby's Commission, I was asked to present there, and I put up a slide of the hypocrisy stuff. And there was Senator Ed Lawson had been... I said, this is one of your own has done this. He was a strong opponent of any ability to have private health insurance or private pay. And he said he developed a heart problem and had to use his Teamsters Union insurance to go down and have surgery in the United States. And I said, this is hypocrisy. This is absolute hypocrisy by one of the members of your own Senate. And suddenly all the heads turned to look, and I didn't know he was there sitting at the table, but there was Senator Ed Lawson. He says, well, yeah, I've changed my mind. And they said, well, what do you mean you changed your mind? I said, well, it's different when it applies to you. And that's the problem. There is, you know, one of if you look through our plaintiffs at Charter Health website, and you will find a child of 15 who waited 27 months in BC to get in to the children's hospital and has ended up paralyzed for life. This would not happen in any other developed country on earth, and we can't allow this to carry on. You can have, by the way, complete universal healthcare without a private system. I lived in Switzerland for 6 months. Mostly private hospitals, mostly private insurance, and those who are poor and can't afford the insurance, the canton pays the premiums for them, and they get the same access and the same hospital as rich people. So universal, we don't need the government to poke its nose in every single aspect of our lives, so that's where I'll pass it back to you.
So again, I think the format we agreed on is just a very short further comment in light of what we've heard, and then open it up to you. And since I had the benefit of hearing Brian first, my comment should be even shorter since I've had an opportunity to speak. And I think the points raised really don't reflect that significant a chasm of desired outcomes, which is the best possible healthcare system that meets the needs of the most. In a way that is the most cost-effective. That again, the challenge is who's in the position to organize and manage and understand and run that. And it struck me as Brian was talking, there's just one anecdote I'll share for this last bit, which is how I begin my classes on federalism when I teach that area, hearkening back to the earlier talk of Craig's on this other area of the Constitution that I think actually causes most of what ails healthcare, never mind the Constitution solving it, because it makes this system amazingly more complex and dysfunctional than it needs to be through making it a provincial head of power, division of legislative authority, and yet allowing the federal government to spend money that then has all the strings attached. So when I start that class, and again, this is downtown Toronto or midtown Toronto, it's a very different discussion if it's downtown Chicoutimi or downtown Halifax or downtown Victoria, I know. But at least in downtown Toronto, I always begin with, in what possible world, if your loved one is sick and you go to the hospital, could you ever conceivably care who's funding that hospital? Like, why would we want a world in which the key question on whether that hospital experience is going to be positive or negative is a matter of the predilections of 11 different governments, their funding pickles, their preferences and their priorities, what's in, what's out. Why would we ever say that that's a meaningful local distinction? For example, with the criminal code has to be the same everywhere. Again, the US has different criminal codes in every state. I think that's crazy that you cross a state border and suddenly what you did illegally in the morning is legal. And I say the same thing here. The Constitution makes no sense in the 21st century of healthcare. Whether it made sense in the 19th century, when we were dealing, in fact, with a largely, if not entirely, private system, I leave to another day. But when Medicare was brought in, when Saskatchewan took its leap, and many people say federalism was why that happened, we could have this laboratory in one province. But whatever your view is on that, the federalism parts of the Constitution should have simply been revised to reflect that it would no longer make sense if we want to have a national coherent system to do this. So I think the Constitution is not simply what might or might not solve these problems. In large part, they are caused by including not having a national database on wait lists. Because the other role I play, and I preface this always by saying I'm not here in that capacity, is as a vice chair and member of the Health Services Appeal and Review Board. This is where you go in Ontario if you've gotten services in the US and want OHIP to cover it because it was an emergency or a service not offered in Ontario. And that window, that perch, has actually given me an insight that I think I'd be very keen down the road to talk to Brian about. Because it turns out it is wildly inefficient for Canada to provide a strong number, if not a majority, of the services we do through our hospitals and clinics. In other words, if we sent everyone down to Buffalo for that MRI, we would save literally millions of dollars on getting the next MRI machine and staffing it in whatever part of Toronto, including the transport, stay out in a hotel, whatever the costs are. And in fact, we have a narrow number of things where we've simply made the call in a very opaque way that we're not going to provide that service in Ontario, and we will cover you to go to the US to get it. And when you start asking, what about all these other services that seem to have a two-year wait list? The last one to get notoriety was the gender reassignment surgery through CAMH. There's one place to get referred. There's a two-year wait list to get that initial screening before you can be referred to surgery that will be covered by the state. What possible justification can there be to make someone wait for 2 years to have a first initial, and again, it's under review, it's going to change, it's gotten media, it's gotten headlines. What about the 10 services that don't get that media, that headline? So I think when you pull on the thread, as Brian is pulling, it's not just questions about our charter we should be asking, it's questions about the Constitution and why the national boundaries tend to be as meaningful as they are. And I think if you push on that, what you find is hubris. Not we need to look after patients, not we need to care about doctors, but we cannot say in Canada that we cannot heal people who are sick here because we don't know enough or spend enough or have the expertise or the capacity. If we simply took that out of the equation and said, where is it cost effective to get the treatment you need? Put it on the public purse within the private public mix we now have. I'd like to see how much that changes the equation before necessarily taking the leap of faith that Brian urges. But again, you're the ones who think about this more, at least than I do, probably not as much as Brian does, so I'm keen to hear what's on your mind. Thank you very much.
When people say that there's only one, there should be only one level of care in this country, that's already nonsensical. You know, you have access to care from different things. Like if you know a doctor, you get faster care. If you are a lawyer, often you know a doctor that you get faster care. Politicians get faster care. So we already have multiple levels of care. I think we should just make it fairer and allow people to buy insurance and get the same care as any wealthy person gets.
Do you want to comment on that? I think he might agree.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, to me, this is about lack of access. And you know, I would suggest to Lorne in his next edition of the book, I hope it makes you rich and gets reprinted, but I would like you to change the title to lack of access to care and lack of access to justice. I mean, when the justice, by the way, you might wait 2 or 3 years to get a hip replacement in Canada. We've waited 7 years to get into trial, which is coming this June. So there's that would be a good book. I'll co-author that with you.
No, not only will I take Brian up on the offer, but in real important analogous disclosure, there is this debate on which I take the exact opposite view in legal services. I think it is crazy that we do not have legal expense insurance to ensure that every single person, when a catastrophic legal issue happens, family law, bankruptcy, whatever it might be, that you suddenly have this division between those who get justice because they can afford it and those who don't because they can't. So the legal aid system for criminal defense is notable not for what it covers, but for everything else it doesn't cover that would be as central to any person's well-being in any sense of the word. So the idea that we have a debate about private health insurance and no debate whatsoever about legal insurance is telling in a whole different way, and I stand up and say we need it, and we in fact have had models proposed from Germany, among other places, where this is commonplace in Europe. They cannot understand why we would have uninsured people when this is actually what insurance is best for. You know there's a risk. You don't know when it's going to happen. You don't know who it's going to happen to. But when it happens, you know it is going to be absolutely devastating. That's exactly why God created insurance to begin with. Over to the next.
Thank you. My question is for you, Dean Sossin. It's really two questions. First of all, why, on what basis do you have the faith that you say you have, relatively speaking, in members of parliament or provincial MPPs to determine when and how I should get my health care, but you don't have that faith in judges to determine whether a prohibition or a limitation on my inherent right, recognized by Section 7, to life or security of the person, is demonstrably justified in a free and democratic society. I don't understand that. Can you perhaps expand on your explanation for that?
Yeah, so I mean, I think it's a very a key point, and obviously a key point of difference in the lenses on this issue, you know, that you've heard. So I think there are real important reasons to be depressed by and skeptical about the public debates through parliamentary and other policy mechanisms we've had. You know, I think there was a blip in the election back in 06 where this could have been an issue for the Conservative Party and quickly was swept under the rug because it was seen as political suicide. It's the third rail. I think that does an incredible injustice to our debates and much of what I've been trying to suggest ought to be a very hard, evidence-based, you know, fair, equitable, cost-effective look at this. But on the other hand, you could say the same thing about any number of absolutely critical areas in our social and economic life. And we have that political system and its frailties, federalism and others, unless we have the political will to change them. What I think we can't do is use a group of vitally important appointed officials there to do things within a wheelhouse around constitutional rights or legal rights to perform that work as a workaround, a political system that doesn't function as it should. I think that is not only likely to be ineffective, as ineffective or ineffective in different ways than the political system, but also illegitimate. And more significantly, it's the illegitimacy problem that concerns me. But I don't disagree with the basis on which you say it, and I think reasonable, well-informed people on this issue can and should disagree on that point. And I welcome the contribution to the discussion.
Can I just add on the political scheme? I mean, Canada, and I agree with you on the fact, Canada has 14 ministries of health for a population of 35 million or so. France, with double the population, has one ministry of health. It was once strongly hinted by a senior person in government or asked if I would consider going into politics, being Minister of Health, and they said, well, I said, you know, only on one condition. And they said, what was that? I said that if I became Minister of Health, my first action would be to abolish the Ministry of Health and just have the money sent directly from finance to the health institutions. But you know, the reason this has become politicized, and you might ask, one of the reasons I believe politicians are inhibited is we have the equivalent in Canada of a small, powerful lobby group in Canada that is bullying politicians just in the way that the NRA bullies politicians in the United States on gun control. And you might ask, when the majority of individuals in the United States favor more gun control, how come the politicians won't act? Well, the question is, the majority of Canadians in every single poll that's been done favor their right to access healthcare if the government doesn't provide it. In BC, it's up at 90%. We have a coalition of public sector unions, groups called good sounding names like the Canadian Health Coalition, which housed in the Canadian Labour Congress and funded by trade unions, who are afraid of competition, and that's why the political thing. But I, more than anyone, would love to see the ministries in Canada downsized to just one. We don't need 14, certainly.
So thank you for your presentations. Just a quick view of a newcomer to Canada. Honestly, my biggest fear is to get sick or somebody in my family to get sick in Canada before I make enough money to go and get it privately outside of Canada. That's been my experience for the 8 years here. And my question is to you, Lorne, what is, in your opinion, the moral basis for the government to have any say in what I can choose in terms of services that I can get from anybody? So I understand the debate, public, private, I get it, but where does this come from? Thank you.
You know, it's a when you say the moral basis, of course, you're infusing it with a deeper rationale than the ones often given. There's two rationales, one moral, one not necessarily. The not necessarily is because there are statutes to that effect and penalties in place, and that is the same distinctions made, for example, on why you have to see a lawyer to get legal services or
and
a regulated
should.
Engineer. And
yep.
there's all sorts of distinctions that, again, say, even though there's a market where I could get it cheaper and, in my view, better, I'm not permitted to do so, nor is that person permitted to offer that service without risk or penalty. Morally, I think it is this claim, contested and contestable as it is, to the only way to achieve effective equity and fairness across the system is to have universal risk and universal cost. And again, that is an article of faith. It should be treated as an article of faith, not a truth, not a gospel, to be tested by evidence for sure. But that is where the moral authority emanates from, that view that if you even go down the European road of parallel hybrid systems for the same services and divide up which physicians practice in which, even with this thought that the public purse could pay for the private insurance for those who can't afford it, you will have crossed a Rubicon that undermines the moral basis for this compact, which to now anyway continues to enjoy broad political support. I think when you cut into it and ask the kind of questions that Brian is asking, would private health care undermine it or not, you get different responses. But do you support universal health care continues to be a bedrock principle. Whether it's moral or not is open to and should be subject to debate.
Thank you.
Can I just say that, I mean, one of the examples we use all the time in Canada, I happen to be a good friend of a fellow called Tony Castro, who is Fidel Castro's son. I once sat this close to him for 7 hours to Fidel talking about healthcare, and I'm an honorary member of the Cuban Orthopedic Association. I like to say that to show my socialist credentials.
I'm not a member of any association in Cuba, I should add.
Yes. But Fidel believed that the two most important things a country can give its people is number one, education, and number two, healthcare, in that order. And in Canada, and we have no problem with private education. No one is going around suggesting that all the good teachers have left public universities and public schools to go to the private sector. What we have instead as an answer to that in Canada is a restriction on the rights of qualified doctors to work. There are hundreds, the biggest wait lists in Canada right now are in my field of orthopedic surgery, yet there are 172 highly qualified, newly qualified orthopedic surgeons who can't get a job because the hospitals won't give them operating room time, and that's why we have wait lists. So this is what happens when the government promises universality with a fixed budget and there's no... I had a letter several months ago from a lawyer in Rome who said, you know, he was shocked after reading some of our case because he thought Canada was a great country, except he now realizes that its health system is designed for the very rich that can afford to go down to the United States. That was an outsider's lawyers, a health expert lawyer on Canada's health system.
Thanks again for the presentation. I kind of have to reconstruct my question because it's been some sort of asked in two previous questions, so I'll change it a little bit. But for you, Dean Sossin, you mentioned this the moral idea, whether you agreed with it or not, of an accessible and equitable system. I guess my question would be, how is that moral argument, whether you disagree with it or not, how is that applied in like the legal reality that we have? Like, is it just based on this idea that democratic society is able to step on individual right to seek care? Or where does that moral basis enter the real world, I guess?
Yeah, look, I think that's the lived reality that leads to so many tales of pain and suffering and people who feel like this provision, whether or not it has a moral basis, is visiting on them an unjustified suffering. And I don't disagree with, and like most people in this room, have experienced instances of that unfairness, or the unfairness that we call it single tier, because we all know if you have enough money, you'll go elsewhere. So it's two-tier in a kind of clandestine way that we can live with, because it siphons off the people who might otherwise be the loudest to, I mean, none of that's good, right? But I think at the end of the day, the question about what basis is there to restrain people from exercising that freedom is analogous to a whole range of other areas where we have that debate in our political realm, where we've tried to have it, I would suggest, without great success in the judicial realm. Like, for example, the freedom to buy a firearm, the freedom to live in a particular kind of a space without someone else who you disagree with visiting their lifestyle or their approaches or their beliefs on you. The balancing, in other words, is precisely what those policy preferences and debates are about. In this case, the balance to prevent someone in certain areas, so not the 30% where there can be in our private clinics, but in the 70% where there isn't, what that might look like. And again, I'd suggest that's also a place that, because the ideological baggage is so weighty, we don't look at very much. Why don't we make orthopedic surgery seen in a different light than cardiac heart surgery? Or why is cataracts not the same as getting a pair of glasses? All those distinctions are, of course, medically significant, but also significant in policy and other areas. And at the end of the day, it all comes down to an allocation of distinctions that I would suggest you can't justify on charter grounds. Those are not the kind of fine-tuning distinctions, what's in or out of that system, that we're ever going to get right as a matter of constitutional law before a group of judges. But I appreciate the point. Again, I think it's an important one. Resonates with me, for sure.
Thank you.
I'd like to get Lorne as an expert for our case. Yeah.
Someone who's new to the debate is about to speak.
Yeah. Yeah, I was sort of persuaded by your critique of judicial policy making, except that I think it's way too late. I mean, the judges are making up law all over the place. Yeah. They are making up
Up policy.
Not, well, yeah, but it's also law. They're making up policy by way of making new law. They're creating a right to gay marriage, a right to assisted suicide. They've created an entirely new doctrine of Aboriginal title. So by what, how can you possibly say people who are interested in creating a right to buy private health insurance, no, you shouldn't go to the courts? I mean, is there something unusual? I think the door is open. The courts have become part of the Canadian political process, and they make policy whether they admit it or not, and we can't arbitrarily talk to one group of people and say, you can't try. I mean, if the game is open, I think it's open for everybody.
Yeah, and again, I mean, Brian will have views on that, but to the extent it was directed at my presentation, again, I think it's an absolutely important and well-justified critique of the position I'm raising. So the question is, why is healthcare different, in other words, than these various other areas? And I might, you know, having showed the card earlier on the view I have of Gosselin, I think social welfare rights, and I've argued elsewhere, ought to be subject to the Charter. I think it's impossible for me to see fundamental rights and freedoms that don't include some minimum standard of the basic necessaries of life. How can you have security of the person and freeze in the dark? I'll never understand. But if healthcare is exceptional, it would be on two grounds, one principled, one pragmatic. The principled ground would be its universality, that other areas affect particular communities in particular ways at particular times. Healthcare affects everyone all the time. And second, in its intensity, scope, and complexity. Not every other area is a majority of the state budget to which taxes support, with the complexities of federalism, of physicians versus medicines, of all of those different moving parts, all happening at once. So to the extent we worry about courts generally getting involved in policy, prostitution, same-sex marriage, whatever it is, this is that to, you know, on steroids in every sense of the word, because of that size, scope, and complexity. So I think for both that principled reason that it is distinct, if not unique in its universality, and distinct, if not unique in its complexity and breadth, the argument, which may have traction elsewhere and there may be more debate elsewhere, here it seems to me unassailable that this is simply not something, given what can come forward in litigation in the record, judges can in any way be well placed or even able to do justice to, which is a point I know at a meta level you've subscribed to in many different contexts, and there is a a cherry-picking element to this that I accept as a really viable critique of this view. Why was it okay in the social welfare or prostitution or other setting? And I think that's something the court's going to have to grapple with itself when it no doubt hears the arguments I'm making that it's not well-placed to make these kind of calls.
I just had to say, it was already alluded to that the Quebec government essentially ignored Cheroli. They did not do what the Supreme Court of Canada told them to do. They legalized insurance for hip replacements and cataracts. Well, who's going to go and buy, which insurance company is going to create a policy in case you need a cataract operation or a hip replacement? And you know, one of the problems I see with the Supreme Court of Canada is it's open to interpretation by the government, and then there's no, you almost have to go back to court to get them to do something about it. But what we saw in Quebec was what happened in British Columbia, and I was told this by some people I know in Quebec. In British Columbia in 2008, the BC Automobile Association, based on nothing to do with us, they had independent advice that Cheroli applied in BC, and therefore they offered their 800,000 members they were about to offer them health insurance. They got an underwriter and so on to cover private insurance, and then they withdrew it. And I found out later that the reason they withdrew it is that the teachers' union and several other unions told them they would take away all of their insurance business and travel business if they offered such policies. So they withdrew it. And in Quebec, the government made it very clear to insurance companies that they would not be looked upon kindly if they offered private insurance in Quebec. So there are other issues beyond the power of the Supreme Court of Canada, and that is governments can ignore what is said, and it's then up to an individual to go back to court again and fight. So I think our case will be precedent setting for the rest of Canada. And one of the things we have to do, which did not happen in Quebec, is the physicians in British Columbia will have to force the government to respond in the manner that the Supreme Court rules they should.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for your presentation. Unfortunately, I found it to be the most depressing of the day, considering...
Well, wait, there's more coming.
I mean, we talked about patents and civil asset forfeiture. Those things are people's property. Here we're dealing with people's lives. I just have a question and a comment. About 20 years ago, a family friend who would go on to sell his medical scanner company to GE Medical Services told me that through all of his contacts, he determined, and I have not been able to verify this, but he determined that roughly half of OHIP was spent on keeping people alive for the last 2 weeks of their life. Now, 20 years later, I would ask you to...
It's about the last year of life that you think, about 70% cost.
I guess he answered my question. I was going to ask you to comment and find out what approximately that was today. He's saying about a year today, in terms of roughly half of OHIP is spent on keeping people alive, I guess, for the last year of their life. My comment would be that in the past 4 weeks, I've given up 2 liters of my blood, and that blood was tossed into the garbage. Why? Because the Canada Blood Services has rules regarding how often you're supposed to give blood, and they have, you know, a lot of bureaucratic procedure. I went out of my way 2 years ago when I gave up 2.5 liters of my blood, and this is due to a rare iron overload disorder that I have, which, you know, if I ignore it for a long period of time, eventually it could threaten my health. So 2.5 liters was thrown out 2 years ago. I went to Canada Blood Services. I practically begged them via email to allow me to provide the blood, again, without charge, because that would be wrong. And by the way, Canada Blood Services buys blood from the United States, who does pay their donors. I have the highest value blood. I have O positive blood, which everyone can accept, so it is the highest value. And yet, 2.5 liters was thrown out 2 years ago. 2 liters thus far has been thrown out this year. And I just want to let that sink in for everyone in the room.
So first of all, it's very cool to be O-positive, so congratulations on that. The second second point, though, and it's a good point, and notwithstanding Brian's Cuban credentials, that I think gets made too rarely, which is the market is really good at doing some fundamental things in healthcare. The competition, the accountability, the transparency, the driving down of costs and up of value is what markets in every other field we know can be enormously successful at. We've seen markets be incredibly dysfunctional in other areas, but why not take the areas where we think there's real value to the market and integrate that market, which is happening in some areas. The scanning area, in fact, is one that you could point to as an evolution from public to private, or the P3 construction. Problems with all that too, growing pains and glitches. But I think the problem with the ideological position we find ourselves in, and I meant it when I referred to that those moral principles of the universal healthcare as articles of faith, is that people react the way you do when you believe in a faith-based system, which is you brook no compromise that is existential, that undermines the very basis of your beliefs. So instead of looking at it as how do we get to the outcomes that are best, and what mixes of public and private delivery, allocation, rationing, et cetera, will get us there, we end up saying, are you part of this faith or that faith? And begin to visit all sorts of aspersions and assumptions if you don't subscribe to a faith. And I think that is a very challenging way to go about something this fundamental to this many people. And I hope to never be in a position of needing your blood, but I hope to know that it's out there if ever I do.
Okay. Well, I'd just like to say I'm O-positive also.
Who knew?
And 40-something percent you'd be even more desirable if you were O-negative. But just to allude to the waste, I'm pleased that Lorne is on this Ontario commission that looks at and reviews expenditures in out of country, because one of the things happened, one of the personal experiences of our clinic about several years ago, there was a patient from Ontario who needed an ankle replacement, and we had the surgeon who had the expertise to do this ankle replacement. I know that might irk Torontonians to think that BC had more expertise in an area than they do, but so we offered to do this procedure all in, counting doctor's fees, hospital fees, and cost of the implant, for $15,000 Canadian. Instead, we got a letter. We then got a letter from the Ontario organization that, and this was way before your time, saying that they are philosophically opposed to supporting private healthcare in Canada, and therefore they've decided to send the patient down to the United States, and the cost of the procedure in the United States was $35,000 US. That was a time when the Canadian dollar was 63 cents. On the dollar. So that's the problem with ideology getting in the place of common sense, and it's another example of waste that goes on when ideology takes over from economic common sense.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Central planning will always create long lines.
thank you both for your talk. I enjoyed it immensely, Dr. Day and Dean Sossin, and thanks to the Constitution Foundation for having this. I wanted to challenge you. You said it's ideological, it's faith-based. I think it's fairly reasonable to take faith in evidence. And so I'm pushing back a bit on something you've said at least three times now, Dean Sossin, that we just have to take it on faith, that this is the right thing to do. It's the morally correct way to support a universal system. Well, actually, the literature is quite clear that in our so-called universal system, a person of low socioeconomic status accessing the identical care and service as someone from a higher socioeconomic status will wait longer and have much more difficulty accessing that service and care. So that's settled. That's a fact. The evidence is there, and I can get you many papers to show that. So we do not have the moral high ground in our current so-called universal system. And on top of that, many European systems that have a blended approach have again shown conclusively that those of the most disadvantaged economic classes in society have much better access to life-saving and preventative medical treatment and therapy than we provide in our country. So actually, blended healthcare systems improve access and care for those who need it most. So I would challenge you, and I look forward to your comments, to stop saying that we have the moral high ground by throwing around the word universal care. We do not. We are letting down our most disadvantaged people in our society right now, and we can no longer throw around the word universal care as a prop for a system that is disadvantaging our most needy patients in our society.
You know, I appreciate the comment, and in fact, if I've come across as an adherent, I should clarify, I'm an agnostic. What I'm asserting is that the governments who've put in place the system we have, both federally with the spending power underlying its vision of universality, and then provincially in terms of the actual legislation that gets challenged that prevents seeking private health insurance, that it's justified, I think, as an article of faith about universality, to which I believe it ought to be subject to the rigors of evidence and scrutiny and review. But I think this is the ideological or faith-based part. Can you get outside of what you know to be true and fact-based to see how someone else is looking at those same studies or different ones coming to the same firmness of view, but the opposite view? And I think Brian was great in showing the graph that if you look at the horizontal one way, it's not that the facts changed. Facts are the facts. You look at the horizontal one way, and we've got stable situations throughout Canada over time. You look at it another way, and it's going up. And the purchase or the traction to the argument I'm putting forward is not that we ought to decide this on moral certainty or truisms. It ought to be evidence-based, but that the court is uniquely poorly suited to sort out which horizontal line is appropriate with its expertise and vantage from the charter versus what ought to be an evidence-based policymaking discussion that ought to consider everything on the table. So when I was referring to the conservatives earlier who flirted with and then swept under the rug whether universality would be a subject of debate in a campaign, I think, and it's not just the conservatives, it's all parties, I think that's what serves us poorly. I mean, Tony Clement and I taught a course actually at U of T at the law school on politics and the policy process. And he said, I want to come with the political conviction that we were all certain of when we came into government provincially in the Mike Harris government that never got done. And I want to explain how law is why it never got done. And what was that part of the campaign platform that had universal support throughout the province? It was a patient's bill of rights. Everyone wanted a patient's bill of rights. Wait times won't be a problem. The commitment is you will not wait for hip surgery more than insert number of months here or cataracts or anything else. It is a commitment. It's rock solid. It's your charter carried in your back pocket. And when Tony Clement became Minister of Health, it was a midway through the mandate and said, I don't get it. This was rock solid on the campaign trail. We love this stuff. This is who we are. Why is it not done? And one after another, government council, senior, you know, deputy ministers, others said, well, if you do that, it's kind of like McGuinty's pledge for 20 students or less in elementary grades. You hope you don't have a kid in grade 7, as I did at the time, wallowing, you know, in a class of 37, because you will create distortions, you will create dysfunctions. You don't even know the direct or inadvertent consequences of that Bill of Rights. Law is the worst lever or fulcrum, you know, absolute hardline universal rights in a situation that has got to be fluid and responsive to the evidence, to how it changes, to technology, to the dynamism. That's politics and messy policy work. It should be evidence-based, everything should be on the table, but that's not the stuff of Section 7 of the Charter, would be my response. But I take the point and I take the concern and critique of how I've expressed my views very much to heart and appreciate it.
I for one, would much sooner judge
rules on this than we leave it up to politicians. And even politicians that you might think, I mean, I could show you quotes from Stephen Harper that you would swear were stated by Jack Layton. I can on Medicare, and I was on a panel with sitting maybe appropriately to the right of Ralph Klein and Mike Harris, and they both were had done their stints as premiers, and essentially they both pronounced that yes, that we should have go along the route of the European social democracies and allow a hybrid system. And I stood up and faced them both and said, well, you were both premiers. You both had it in your power with big majorities, and you did nothing. Why did you do nothing? And their answer was, well, the timing wasn't right then, but the timing's right now. In other words, I don't have to take the flak. So I don't think give me a judge any time over a politician.